tap is the battle for the top spot in the Greater Miami Conference. Tonight, it's Fairfield and Mason. It's the Greater Miami Conference on Chatterbox Live. And good evening from Fairfield. I'm Geoff Kim. Trace Fowler to join me in just a moment. In a game you saw right here on Chatterbox Live 3 nights ago, the Indians were on the wrong side of a Will Williams buzzer beater in Middletown, falling to the Middies 50-48. Logan Woods led all scores, however, in that one with 13 points. Meanwhile, despite a game-high 27 points from Trey Killens, it was the Comets falling to Lakota East at home last Tuesday, 53-51. So as we bring in Trace, let's start with visiting Mason. The Comets are probably mindful of the school on the jersey. They're 8-0 against the teams this season not named Lakota East. Still, the Comets have the best overall record in the GMC outside the conference, thanks to having the league's best defense and led by the league's best scorer.
Yeah, Trey Killens is a baller, if you will, and you'll be able to see that pretty quickly when you start watching them play. But they're well coached and they're well disciplined, and I got a chance to watch them play against Oak Hills, and those were two like-minded teams, if you will, very structured on the defensive end. But the difference is that Mason has some scorers, and they're led by like the guy you mentioned, Trey Killens.
Trey Killens averaging 22.5 points per ball game. I mean, he is absolutely lighting it up in the GMC this year. Meanwhile, we're trying to figure out which Fairfield team we'll see tonight. A week ago at Lakota East, we saw the Indians hit the long ball. They were 6 of 16 over at the Hawks Nest, and they went on a 12-0 run to start that game, held on for a three-point win. The game 4 days later in Middletown, a little different. It saw them fall behind by double digits. They had a hard time defending, and they went 2 of 9 from the line. They ultimately lost at the buzzer. So, Trace, which Fairfield team shows up tonight?
Well, it's tough to say, right? I don't know if we know quite yet, but I think the biggest thing is just understanding who they are, and that's just a young team. And they're going to have those types of situations where there's one game that they play really well, and then there's another game where you kind of scratch your head. But I will say this. This league is kind of – it'll make you scratch your head because Middletown's a team where I thought, you know, they were going to compete in every game they played in. They come in, they lose to Hamilton by 30. They turn around, and then they beat this Fairfield team who had not been beaten in the league yet. So I'll be honest, I can't quite figure this whole situation out in the GMC, but I think some of it has to do with the youth of Fairfield, and that's why you have some inconsistency. But if you're going to be happy as an Indians fan, you got to realize that you'll take that considering they all seem to be sophomores and you got them for quite some time.
Well, you know, it's funny. We talk about this with the pro sports, and we don't always see this in the high school game. Parity is so key to keeping everybody immersed into a season throughout that season. The last time these two teams met, it was on February 14th, Valentine's Day, last year now, in Mason. The Comets won it 75-58. Matthew Smith, who you'll see tonight, came off the bench in that one. He led all scores with 14 points. That capped off a season sweep as the Comets won in Fairfield on January 17th last year, 62-42. And something to be said here on this one, this is an important game for Fairfield, not just to stay on top of the league, Trace, but Mason has won 11 straight in this series. The last time the Indians beat the Comets, you have to go back to February 11th, 2014. Here in Fairfield, they won 62-48.
Yeah, wow. That's a long time coming, if you will. And I will say there's a reason for that, and most of it is like I said, the coaching, if you will, of Mason. They're not going to be inconsistent. Mason isn't. And I do say this, though. Fairfield's a team where when you walk in the gym and you go to play them, you're going to have a little fear. You're going to be a little mindful of the talent they have on that side of the ball because those guys, if you get Rodgers going inside and you get a guy like Logan Woods hot from the outside, you're going to have trouble. And then you add in a guy like Deshaun Krim, and it adds doom. So ultimately, we'll find out which team comes out tonight, which team has success early. I think we'll help dictate how this goes. But maybe for the Indians fans, it'll be a new year and new timing, if you will.
Well, and here's a weird thing going into this game. Both teams have come off losses. They're near the top of the division. In the case, Fairfield is at the top of the division. It'll be a losing streak for somebody after 32 minutes tonight.
Absolutely. And I would say this. If either one of these squads wants to make a stake and say we're the ones that belong at the top echelon of this league, we are not a flash in the pan.
And we are due for a break. When we come back, we'll have the starting lineups and the opening tip. This is the Greater Miami Conference on Chatterbox Live. We're just mere moments away from the start of this one here at Fairfield Arena. Along with Trace Fowler, I'm Geoff Kim. Thanks for joining us. It's our feature game this week here on Chatterbox Live, featuring the Greater Miami Conference. As we await the starting lineups here in this one, we'll give you first for the Mason Comets. You'll see, we'll give you the starting lineups here. Number 4, Trey Killens, at 6 foot tall, 160 pounds, a senior. He'll run with number 5, Eli Jordan, 6'1", 195 pounds, a senior. Number 12, Alex Morton, 6'2", 180 pounds, a junior. Number 15, Matthew Smith, 6'3", 190 pounds, a senior. And number 20, Max Johnson, 6'1", 180, a senior.
One thing to keep in mind when you just rattled all those off, you got 4 seniors, 1 junior. Not quite the same on the other side.
No, not at all. And we're expecting a pretty good show here at Fairfield as we await Fairfield getting their lineups on in. As you see, the lights come on down here at Fairfield Arena. And we'll take you, we'll shut up here for a second and let you listen on in. Give you the starters now for Fairfield after you saw that beautiful montage. We'll get that to a second. The guards are number 2, Deshaun Krim, 6'1", a sophomore. Number 5, Julian Mitchell, 6'4", a sophomore. And number 33, Ray Coney, 6'1", a sophomore. Up front, it's number 3, Logan Murphy, 6'2", a senior. And number 24, Amir Rogers, 6'5", a sophomore. The head coaches for this one for Mason, in with a record of 8-2, 4-2 in the GMC. It's Greg Richards in his 26th year. 379 and 174 is his career mark. And meanwhile, on the other side, DJ Wyricks in his second year with the program, 13-20, after coming on board from Vandalia Butler, where he was 57-37. Trace, before we hit anything else, I got to tell you, when watching that montage, it was a little different to hear your own voice be a part of a montage. But there you go.
Yeah, I did not know that they had a couple Chatterbox clips in there, but I guess we'll take it. As they turn the lights back on, thankfully, I got one funny or quick story, I should say. I was at a Woodward game when I was a kid that my dad took me to when he was scouting. They turned the lights off to something similar to the same effect. They wanted to hype everybody up. They went to turn the lights back on, and I don't know, but yeah, the old school lights, it took about 25 more minutes for them to turn back on. The game did not start for another half hour.
By the way, speaking of starting light, the freshman game, by the way, went double overtime, and it's 8:14 right now on the clock. As we're ready to jump center, Alex Morton will jump center there with Amir Rogers, tapped out to the sideline. It belongs to Fairfield, and away we go here at Fairfield Arena tonight. Fairfield, as you see, in the home whites with the red, or the scarlet trim, if you will, and it's the green uniforms with the white trim and numerals for visiting Mason. Deshaun Krim gets the first touch, and he plays over Logan Murphy. Woods.
Nice.
Over for Rogers, 2-0 Fairfield.
Yeah, too easy. Good job by Woods of crashing the lane and then finding Rogers with an interior pass. And like I said, on Tuesday's game against Middletown, Rogers finds himself with about 8 points a game where he just has to lay it in.
It's Alex Morton handling, plays to the side. Killens returns it up top, Eli Jordan. Getting a touch now, Matthew Smith. Back to Killens, now plays Smith, deep along the sideline, goes baseline, kicks it out to the other side. They'll reset.
A lot of flex cuts on this Mason offense.
Max Johnson, we finally call his name. Ball tapped back, but saved. Eli Jordan, who plays some football for this Mason team. In the fall, has it, and then they play it back. Killens averaging 22.5 a ball game. Checked there by his man, and he makes it that 2-2 game.
Yeah, Woods couldn't have done a whole lot better with that, and Killens was able to find the bottom of the basket. And quite frankly, I was going to say it was a tough shot, maybe a bad shot, but not when it goes down.
Killens is shooting 47% from the floor. Rogers, he can't get two more here, and we'll head the other way. It looks like Logan Murphy was over the back of the Mason player.
That he was. Murphy, aggressive guard inside the lane when he tries to grab rebounds. You'll see he'll get two or three offensive rebounds a night, but that time he was a little out of position and led to an offensive foul.
Fairfield will pick up at half court. We're tied at two, a minute and a half gone by here at Fairfield Arena. Matthew Smith, who we had mentioned in the pregame, leading the last time these two teams have met, a couple of times, in fact. He sets a screen and a moving one out there for Killens. A lot of motion on the perimeter, Trace.
That it is.
Killens for three off the wing, no good. The rebound to Deshaun Krim for Fairfield. He wants to run up the side. To the rack he goes. The up and under, missed the shot. Saved by Fairfield. It's loose on the floor and taken away by Mason. And they'll keep possession. No need for a timeout here. Killens quickly up the floor. It's Smith into the lane. He draws the double team. He gets it back.
So far they have Woods on Killens, who's their best defender. You would think perhaps Krim would guard him, but they wanted Woods to take that responsibility.
Morton traveled. Alex Morton is 6'2", 180 pounds, a junior, averaging about 14 points a ball game. Early on in the season, he and Trey Killens were jockeying for top position in the GMC. Morton has since fallen off a little bit in scoring, but 14 a game is still awfully good.
Yeah, anytime you're averaging double figures from the scoring column, it means that you know how to put the ball in the bottom of the basket. Now, the question is for Mason, can they find a way to use some of their back cuts? There's a lot of aggressive defending on the Indians' part, as I think they're trying to sort out something on the scores table. I think it's just the possession arrow. And they got that squared away, and we'll get back to play here. But at some point, you got to take advantage of the over-aggression from these Indians, and that's easier said than done.
Still tied at two. 2.5 minutes gone by here in this one. Ray Coney gets his first legitimate touch up high on the right. Woods, jabs, three, no good. Rogers the rebound, and his size is going to be a difference tonight.
That it will. Eli Jordan kind of got himself in a position where he just was overmatched from a height perspective. You can kind of see him wrapping that arm around and pulling Rogers, and he's going to pick up the personal.
Team fouls are even at one with 5:14 to play here in this first quarter. Here's Krim triggering three, no good, off the back iron. Drive for Coney for two. Beg your pardon, Luke.
Yeah, you had it right the first time. Okay. Coney with the easy basket, snagged the offensive rebound right around that three-point arc and had a clear lane as Killens is going to travel.
Still 4-2 here in this one. You know, it's funny, sometimes, and for reference here for our viewers, you know, you still get your normal center court shot, whereas Trace and I, we're perched above, and that's a regular thing for us in GMC arenas. However, we're perched towards the Mason bucket here at this point, so we don't get always the greatest shots on the opposite end. And that was a long-winded explanation on me trying to excuse myself on not knowing if it was Coney or not on that last
bucket. That's a long-winded bucket. Way of saying you have bad eyes. Is that what it is?
Here's a three for Woods, no good. 0-2 for three here in the early go for Fairfield.
You got numbers due to the Mason comments, but good job of the Indians of getting back on defense.
Killens pulls it on the floor, back outside, Max Johnson. And they work around the arc again with 4:29 to go here in this opening quarter.
Yeah, Killens had Johnson right there on another pass if he'd have made the quick angle to it. But he didn't see Johnson, and now they're going to have to play through this tough Indians defense.
Spin around, Smith stuck, nearly threw it away, saved by Mason.
Look at the hustle.
Killens saved it for his teammates. They work it back around for Smith. Killens top of the key. Great on the ball defense by Deshaun Krim. Back outside, Johnson to step around, 18 feet away, no good. We'll get the other way. Right now, after the initial salvos by each team, Trace, both teams finding it a little hard to find buckets.
Yeah, I think that Fairfield on that possession right there played one of the best defensive sets, if you will, that I've seen all year. And they've done a good job of rotating. They're helping. If their man gets beat, there's someone there to kind of take their place. If they play defense like that tonight, there's no way they're going to get beat.
Coney picks up inside the free throw line. Outside, Murphy for three. He knocks it down. 7-2, Fairfield.
Yeah. Big bucket right there by the senior, and if you get a guy like that going early, get some confidence, that might be an X factor tonight.
I don't know if we often call 5-0 runs a run, but right now it is, with 3:20 to go here in the first. Matthew Smith, who's a really good sharpshooter, taking a secondary role on this team this year with the emergence of Trey Killens. The other, other way.
You can see right here, Geoff, on the replay, Coney does a good job of driving in, hitting Murphy on the outside, and he caught it in rhythm and was able, like I said, if he gets going early, you never know, right? Confidence is a big factor, especially at this level, and I would even argue at the collegiate and professional level as well, but more so at the high school level. Seeing the first one go down makes a big difference.
Well, remember, one of the things about this Fairfield team is their lack of ability from a seasonal standpoint to shoot the three. Right now hitting 26% of those shots. Here's a drive for Coney. Shot off, and it's taken away. I think when we saw them a week ago at Lakota East at the Hawks Nest, they were shooting 19% at that time. So it's gone way up.
Wow.
Beauty shot there.
Yeah, Killens, I think, almost hit the rafter with the floater.
That breaks the 5-0 run for Fairfield, 7-4. 2 minutes to play here in this first quarter. Rogers puts it on the deck to the rack, and he is shut off, and this one tapped away from him out of bounds. It will stay up front with 2:27 to go.
For as aggressive a defense of both of these teams playing, we only have three team fouls, and I don't think we've seen either team go to the line.
No, yeah, exactly. And that's a testament right now to the officials calling it tight, but not overthinking it at this point. Coney putting it on the deck. Checked by Killens to the rack. He goes, missed the shot. Smith the rebound for Mason. A three will tie it up for the Comets. Smith rolls on in, left hand, pretty layup.
Yeah, good job of Smith using his strong hand right there, and you can see him with the easy left hand.
Averaging 10 a ball game, he's shooting 46% from the floor, 7-6, a little 4-0 run to answer back for the Comets.
Yeah, you can tell Krim's a little frustrated so far. He hasn't been able to get to the lane, and when he's gotten to the lane a few times, he hasn't been able to finish, and he's starting to kind of let that pester him maybe a little too much. Let the game come to you a little bit more.
One-point contest here in the early go. Well, if nothing else, I'll tell you this. Whether he's been setting up at the post or driving in, Rogers has looked good here in the early minutes as he gets the rebound.
Yeah, and a good job of Coney of really standing his ground right there on the defensive end.
Speaking of Ray, he has it on the elbow. He'll have to give it up. Deshaun Krim. Oh, nice wraparound pass. It goes to Rogers. He can't put it through. Killens lost the handle initially, got it back. Off the short corner, and he gives Mason the lead.
Killens have a lot of confidence because it was 4-on-1, and he was the one. And he decided he was going to take a little fadeaway runner in the corner, and fortunately it went down for the Comets.
6-0 run for the Comets, under a minute to play in the first quarter. Three for Woods. He knocks it down and gives Fairfield the lead again. Mason thinking three. Smith outside. Now dribbling in. Killen's top of the key. He's been hot to start off. Caleb Pitcock wearing the number 2, and they're also 23, Bryson King. Here's Pitcock for three. He answers back for Mason.
Yeah, big bucket. And I will say this, Geoff, they're letting them play. I mean, they're very physical through these screens, a lot of grabbing, a lot of holding. But I actually prefer that. Otherwise, we'd have a foul fest.
4 seconds to play. Krim off the wing for three. He airmails it, and that's how the first quarter ends. A really interesting first 8 minutes here of this contest. after 8 minutes. It's Mason 11-10 over Fairfield. This is the Greater Miami Conference on Chatterbox Live. 1 point affair here in Fairfield between Mason and Fairfield, along with Trey. I was going to say Trey. Trace Fowler, I'm Geoff Kim. Thanks for joining us here on Chatterbox Live.
Yeah, in that last possession, you said Mason answered. I do believe we got the replay there. You can see just a ball reversal, and he let it rip as well. Similar to Murphy, right? You catch it outside, you feel like you got an opening. One thing that Mason does really, really well, and I don't know if a lot of teams screen as well as they do. I mean, they do a very good job. There's two people, that it requires to set a good screen. It's not just the guy setting the screen. It's the guy coming off the screen, right? If you try to run through that screen too early, then it's ineffective. But also, if you're going to be kind of backing out of the way of a screen, then that's ineffective as well. Mason does a good job with both.
Killens has the ball starting the second half. Checked by Woods. Plays to Smith out on the wing. And now Pitcock up high on the left. Little two-man as Smith finds the baseline. Did he walk the other way?
I think that they are going to get number 23, Bryson King, on an offensive foul away from the ball. And what he did was he just pushed his man, or boxed him out, if you will, up the lane to allow that wide open lane. As well as they've called this game, or the way they've called this game, I did not expect a whistle like that. But, hey, he might have seen something more than I did.
Well, it was amazing, too, because Smith had a lane that was wide open. It was like Moses parting the Red Sea.
Nice play by Murphy.
Beauty.
Just a simple fake handoff. And like I said, you can beat guys with over-aggression if you just play patiently.
Fifth lead change of this ballgame, 12-11, Fairfield by one. Pitcock has it, puts it on the deck, Morton puts it away for two.
Yeah, that was all set up, obviously, by Pitcock.
Sixth lead change of this game already with 7:10 left to go until halftime. They try to work inside. It's turned over. And it's turned back over. Coney answers with two of his own. So I got to say, going back to the game that you saw on Tuesday, Trace, whatever doldrums that they had defensively in that game, I appear to be over with here in this one so far, because we have a foul on this play.
Yeah, just a little over-aggression by Owen Bronson right there. He didn't really have to get into his man as tight as he did, and I do think that was a foul. Just clipped him on the elbow, which is just enough, obviously, to miss the three-pointer short by about 5 feet. Gives a quick indication that you might have got him on the arm.
First free throw for Bryson King, who's averaging 5 points a ball game, is good. He's shooting 5 for 8, so that's 62.5% at the stripe this year. So that's improving, obviously, on the fly. It's amazing, one of those things. Trace, I think back to, like, when you were a player, right? Did you ever look at things like free throws and it's like, hey, if I got 2 for 2 on this game, it would move my percentage, let's just say if you came on in 3 for 5, it would move it to 4 for 5 for 7, and it'd go exponentially higher.
I think when you're a young player and if it's never been taught to you, you let statistics bother you more than they should. And I think that not just me, myself, but I think there was multiple people when I played, we would check statistics way too often, you know. And the thing about high school statistics, quite frankly, is that there's just not long enough of a season to get a really good gauge on where you should be. To your point, if you miss 5 or 6 in free throws in a row just because you had one bad night, that affects the rest of the year.
Meanwhile, we have traveling on the far end, on your left side of the screen there, Logan Woods, as he tried to work his way in. We have the second tie of our ball game, tied at 14 here in Fairfield. You think this was a football score, and we did see Jason Kraus for the Fairfield football team say hello to us here a little bit ago.
That he did. We've had a hell of a time here in Fairfield calling some of his games.
You know, I only got to see Fairfield once during the football season. It was against the team that eventually won the GMC Lakota West. But, oh, my gosh, it's like, you know, the heart and soul of these kids here at Fairfield are something else, especially on the defensive end.
Yeah, one of my favorite players out here, Ray Coney, defensive back for this
yes.
Indian team. And I just think he's a guy that's going to get better and better, man. And when he's a senior, I'm telling you, Ray Coney's going to be a problem.
Pitcock plays it back, and they keep it around. Morton tries to come on in. Back to Pitcock. Well, you think he's a good player. I think he may be Nathaniel Hipsley's favorite player. Three on the way, no good for Pitcock.
Really? You got the inside scoop on that.
Well, the dude and I talk a fair amount. Still tied at 14. Woods trying to create. Stuck at the free throw line. Coney draws the double team up high. Thought he had to call for the timeout, but saves the possession. Krim trying to make a move. You're right. He has been blocked on the way to the hoop a lot tonight. Cleaned up by Rogers for two of his own.
Rogers is, without question, the biggest mismatch for the Indian squad tonight. And that's taking nothing away from the Comets team, certainly taking nothing away from Eli Jordan. But he has such a height advantage, and it's not just the height. He's skilled on the inside.
Amir averages four a ball game. He's got four in this game. It's 16-14. Pitcock pivots. He lost it. He got it back. Three off the wing for King. He knocks it down.
That's one way to beat the big man is on the other end, try to make him stretch his defense to the three-point line. And good job by King of dropping one right in over the big man's hands.
You know, we've seen a ton of lead changes into the game. Are we at nine at this point?
I stopped counting.
Here's Krim, 18 feet away, and he can't get it to fall.
To be fair, I don't know if I ever did start counting.
Eli Jordan plays. Here's King again for three and can't get it this time. Jordan gets the rebound and they'll reset. Three for King, no good. And we saw that first shot, by the way, it was not King, it was Johnson, and we got it straight now. Woods draws the, beg your pardon, Coney calls the double, and he calls for the timeout. With 4:13 left to go here in this first half, Mason has a one-point lead, 17-16.
Yeah, so far back and forth, like you had mentioned, a lot of lead changes, and I think that I don't know if this is really going to separate itself a whole lot in this basketball game. Clearly, obviously, towards the end, maybe one team makes one run that separates it. But I expect this to go back and forth all night, not because of anything other than just the defensive effort and the defensive intensity. And if that doesn't change, like I said, I don't believe we're going to even get above really 6 points in this game either way, which you said. I've had one hell of a run so far, and I'm hoping I get one more tonight.
You know, Trace and I, prior to the ball game, had a little conversation about this, and we'll share with you on this. So he has seen Fairfield two times in a row. This is the third straight game he's seen. By the way, given that's the case, Aaron Blankenship might have to put you on payroll if you do any more games in a row here at Fairfield.
I could use it.
But that being aside, you had seen two straight buzzer beaters. I don't want to say buzzer beaters. Two straight final plays at the buzzer.
One-possession games.
Right. So the game, of course, that we did together last Friday over at East, that came down to a final shot. And then the game over at Middletown that you saw with Nathaniel Hipsley, and that was the Will Williams buzzer beater.
It was. It's like we're going to have a foul here, I believe, on Alex Morton. We'll see.
It is on Morton. That is his first. Four team fouls now on Mason. Three for Fairfield. As we come up on the halfway point of this second quarter. The double team on Coney. He steps through, finding Rogers, and now playing it back. Murphy got a touch. Coney, a little pepper pot move there. Goes back to Murphy. Coney bracketed out up high on the left. And they'll reset. Woods back to the outside. Murphy curls to the elbow. Lost it, got it back. Woods for three off the wing. He knocks it down.
Good job by the Indians of staying patient right there on that offensive set. Led to a good open look for Woods, and he knocks it down. One thing to keep in mind here, Geoff, if you watch, look at the hand checking and the body, I guess the arm bar, if you will, of every single dribble drive on both sides, and they're not calling a block at all.
They are definitely letting them play tonight. And that is a 10th lead change of this game so far, and we're not through half number one. See a new number in there. Well, it's actually Smith. We haven't seen in a little bit, or at least called his name. Smith has it up high. Plays to Eli Jordan for three. He can't get it to fall. Is it possible that somebody can go up by two scores in this one? Coney back outside. Murphy, let's fly for three. He knocks it down. There's your answer.
That is the X factor perhaps tonight. If he shoots the ball, not just in rhythm like that, but with the confidence. Anytime a kid catches the ball and he just lets it rip like that, you know he's feeling it.
Biggest lead of the ball game, 22-17. Drive, Killens to the rack.
Yeah, Killens is just a guy that knows how to score, right? As Reed would say, there's some guys that just wake up out of bed and they just happen to have 20 points before they get out of it. So he's one of those guys, and that's perhaps why he leads the GMC in scoring.
Well, and I think we'll articulate this as we go through this game. He's a volume shooter with quality. Three again for Murphy, no good. And I think they're going to get Amir Rogers this time defensively.
Yeah, that's a tough break for Rogers because I think he was just using his height to his advantage, jumped straight up vertical, and it just looks, the optics of it look poor because it seems like an over the back. But I'll be frank, I don't know if it was really quite the term of over the back or a foul just based off the fact that he has 6-7 inches.
Listed at 6'5", he is the tallest player on either team. Neither team particularly blessed with a lot of height. But I think that's kind of an epidemic in the GMC this year. Smith to the rack, he drew the double, and he drew the foul as well.
Perhaps the 7-footer can offset a little bit of it in the league. What do you think about that?
Absolutely. Hamilton, of course, most of the GMC teams in action tonight, but Hamilton's won 6 in a row, and they've been, I don't want to say the hottest team in the league, but 6 in a row is 6 in a row. Smith makes the first. Of course, you also have East versus West tonight, and to me, outside of this game, that's about as good a game as we would expect to see. Nathan Nedukovich for Lakota West against Nate Johnson for Lakota East, and Smith makes them both.
Yeah, another 20-point win for the Big Blue. You mentioned they're getting hot, and that ought to be a big-time matchup when these Indians play the Big Blue.
I was going to ask you if that game was already over, but I look at our clock and how late we started tonight. I would imagine that game is early, so by 20, huh?
Yeah, 55-35. Or thereabouts, somewhere in that frame. We're kind of like the Pac-12 out here.
Yes, we are.
We're the late night.
We're the late show.
Yeah. Hopefully I'm a little better than Bill Walton, though. That's my goal.
Well, I'm gonna vouch for your partner, Rogers. Can't get the first one to go. He got the second to go. He's got 6.
And that's one way to pad your stats on the rebounds is you throw it up to yourself, grab the rebound, and then put it back in.
Amir is second in the conference in rebounds, 7 a game. I can't wait to see what his rebound totals will look like tonight. 24-21, Fairfield by 3.
This is where Mason has to take advantage of Rogers, right? They're losing size on the defensive end, but can they stretch him right here?
You see 10 in the ball game. 10 is Michael Molnar, team's quarterback. Here's Morton to the rack. He can't get it to fall. Coney quickly up ahead. Woods to the rack. He goes in 1!
Absolutely. Killen's got in a position where he wanted to take a charge, but he was there just significantly too late. And by that time, it's just best to lay off the man, let him lay it in because you've already been beat. Instead, it was an and one. You can see, as I mentioned, just late getting back there, Geoff, and you can see clearly a block and certainly an and one, and we'll see if Woods can deliver on the free one.
And that kiss off the glass, awfully pretty. It's a 5-point contest as Woods goes to the line. He's got 8 in the book tonight, averaging 16.5 a ball game. Team's leading scorer. He makes it. Coming up on 40 seconds to play here in this first half. Entertained for sure. Biggest lead of the ball game at 6. Killens to the rack. He goes. He missed the shot this time. Saved by Smith, and they'll reset.
Yeah, good hands by Smith of saving it right there. It was bouncing out of bounds off Killens, it looked like, and he was able to save the possession.
Morton plays back. Molnar got a touch. Killens for 3, left wing, he airmails it. And we head the other way with 18 seconds to play. I would imagine we'd see a final shot here.
Yeah, we will, and I was surprised that Mason took that shot considering they could have held for the last one. Instead, now you give the momentum already in the Indians' favor and just gives them one more opportunity to kind of add to that going into the half.
So Krim back in. So we roll the clock down towards 10 seconds and counting towards the end of the half. Coney plays Woods. Down low, Rogers swings it back outside. Krim from long range. A three, he airmails that one out of bounds with 1.2 left to go. I think even though he was set up, 25 feet away is still a long shot to try to put in.
That it is, and right here, look for a tip in for Rogers. Some kind of play to get him around the rim.
Coney looking inside, back outside, over the head of Murphy. Krim tries to save it. He throws it up from half court. No good, and this first half has come to a close. Well, I got to tell you, I've been thoroughly entertained here in this one. 10 lead changes and two ties so far through 16 minutes. 27-21, the big lead here. The biggest lead of the ball game for Fairfield. We're due for a timeout. When we come back, Trace and I will break down the first half and look ahead to half number two. This is the GMC on Chatterbox Live. It's the late show here on Chatterbox Live, along with Trace Fowler. I'm Geoff Kim. We say the late show because I think everything else is just about finished up in the league except for us, and we're just at the half. Yeah. Trace, you know, it's an interesting first half to be sure, and I guess we have some numbers to break down here through the first 16.
Yeah, so far a pretty clean game. You can see right there there's only been four turnovers for Fairfield and five for Mason, but the biggest differentiator so far really is the three-point field goal percentage, 44 Fairfield, excuse me. You know what that is? That's that popcorn there.
Yes.
It's like it chips it up here.
Yes.
And 28.6, obviously, for Mason. But you said it. It's gone back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. Lead changes, I think, were in the double digits, 10. So I said I didn't think it'd get over 6. We're at the 6-point margin. We'll see if Mason can kind of prove me right here and they don't let this thing get a little too far out of hand. But I don't think it will. Mason's too good of a team to come in here and go down without a fight.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. You know, as we await the start of this one here in the second half, as Coney awaits to get the ball, and we're back underway as they go left to right. Play of the half, play of the first half so far in this one, Trace.
I think Murphy hitting those back, you know, not back-to-back threes, but those two big threes, if you will, to give him some momentum.
Here's a three for Woods. No good. Murphy has it. And then plays it back up on top. I did like Logan Woods and one late in the first half to expand the lead to two possessions. But we'll have the play of the night or the play of the game coming on up. It's brought to you by Headlines. You'll get to hear it on the Bronx score. Here's a three straight on. Speaking of Murphy.
I mean, like I said before, it just seemed like when he caught the first pass tonight and he's seen it go through, I almost felt like there was a little differentiator there. There was some confidence that I had not seen before from Murphy.
9-point spread. This is the biggest lead of the ball game. Killens to the rack. Can't get it to fall. Woods in his way. He has the ball across half court. He wants to run, and he throws it away. Taken away by Morton.
Yeah, I was getting ready to give Woods a compliment on his defense. There's two games so far that I think he's just been very impressive.
The runner and the floater
wow.
For two.
Are you kidding me, Max Johnson?
His first two of the night. That was pretty.
That's a playground play, something you see at the old Y.
No good for Deshaun Krim. He can't get started, and we got traveling for Amir Rogers.
Yeah, and perhaps he took a couple steps there that I did not see, but I thought Rogers kind of caught that clean. They didn't get him on the over the back, you noticed there on that one. I don't know if Coach Weirich had a little bit of a fireside chat perhaps with those guys in stripes about that situation or not, but I tend to agree Rogers is going to have his way on the inside.
Martin gets a touch. Here's Smith. We got an official stoppage here.
They're going to get a check. That's one of the first times they've called a block all night on Murphy there.
So Murphy, maybe your star of this game so far, 11 points in this game. I always going to say 11 first half, but we just started here in the second, and it's 11 points to lead the way.
Absolutely, and Julian Mitchell does check in for Murphy. So
they work inside. Morton puts it up. No good. He drew contact underneath. So Jalen Berlew, who's seeing his first action of the night, 6'1" guard wearing the number 0, he picks up his first. That's already two team fouls this half for Fairfield. Martin was shut down pretty much in the first half. Had two first half points, averaging 14 a ball game. And he gets on the board here with a couple here in the second half. Fairfield averaging about 54.5 points a ball game. Pretty good at the high school level. The weird thing for Fairfield, they've got a deficit for the season. They're behind in points per ball game by a point a ball game.
Yeah,
but they still have a winning record.
They've had some difficulty out of league for sure, and they've have taken a one real lopsided loss when they played against Wayne up in the GWOC out of Dayton, and they had a tough loss obviously against St. X as well. And both of those games, if you notice, Deshaun Krim struggled a bit. There's the back cut I had mentioned on beating that pressure.
But they can't go to Krim on that. Coney plays back up on top. And it's taken away. Morton to the rack. And in.
Yeah, I think Krim thought it was going to be a turnover, so he kind of pulled up just a little bit there. Don't tell that to Morton, though, because he's seen an easy opportunity to snag it and lay it in, and he did just so.
Alex Morton makes it a three-point contest. And he got another whistle here. He's on a personal four-point run. Speaking of Morton, he picks up his second.
It's like they're going to give Krim a breather for Bronston.
Owen Bronston is 6'4", junior, so they go a little taller here. Not quite a Twin Towers type offense for sure, but a little taller.
No, but Coney definitely has a mismatch on the inside with Killens guarding him, and he's asking for it.
He works around Killens. He puts it up. It's rejected by Killens, but he drew contact.
There's not many young players. And again, I don't want Uber over this kid, but I just tell you, there's not many young players that really have the mindset or the basketball IQ to know I have a mismatch on me. Let me show my will and let me demand the basketball. He did that just there, and now he gets rewarded for two free throws.
Coney to the stripe. He's averaging 5 points a ball game. Just 2 of 7 coming on in at the charity stripe this year, but he makes the first. Trying to up the lead. Can't get the shooter's roll. 1 of 2. Smith the rebound for Mason. Down by 4. Morton looking inside. Stays outside with Matthew Smith. Trey Killens. We got some early points in the first. He's lost, and he lost the ball here. 2-on-1 break. Coney to the rack.
Good little dribble move down there right around half court, which freed him up. And here comes Woods with the steal.
Another 2-on-1 break for Fairfield. Coney to the rack again.
Good job of Woods being unselfish. And I think we're going to get our first timeout from the Comets tonight. And a little bit of a run here for this Indian bunch.
Absolutely. And they're up by 8. This is the biggest lead of the ball game with 4:46 left to go here in this third. And defense turning into instant points, and Ray Coney finishing at the other end is the reason why.
Certainly so. I think that's the biggest point of emphasis right now is just the defensive effort and the defensive intensity so far from Fairfield has led to a couple cheap baskets, if you will. It's hard to get points on this Comet defense when they get down here and they get set, but their offense has obviously struggled a little bit here on I guess, the first half, if you will, of this third quarter, and they're going to probably try to settle things down in the huddle and understand that, hey, you know, we don't have to force anything. We need to let the offense come to us. And eventually, if you set enough screens, at one point the defense becomes tired and they miss an assignment and it leads to a lay-in. We'll see if Mason's a little more patient here. A little less dribbling, a lot more passing.
So just in the last 15 seconds of play, Fairfield has doubled their lead from 4-8, 35-27 out of the timeout. Killen's eyes three. He aims for three. He can't get it to fall.
Good set, though, there, right there for Mason. Good open look for Killens, and that's one that you will take if you are a Comet fan.
Well, and he is a 39% shooter from the arc, from outside the arc, so if you got it, he got the green light. Woods, yeah. Skip pass outside to the far side.
And you could see on that last possession, Coach Richards was kind of giving his guys a encouragement.
Oh, Amir Rodgers for two.
Yeah, he's just a mismatch so far right now. Mason's trying to find who they can put on him to stop him from having that dominance inside the paint.
This is our first double-digit lead of the game at 37-27, under four to play. Pitcock for three. He can't answer. Morton the rebound. Working around Rodgers, draws the foul.
Thomas needed something good for them to happen there, and they finally caught a little bit of a break as Morton, with a little bit of a hesitation, a little bit of a pump fake, got his man in the air and was able to get to the line.
So he had a personal four-point run earlier in this quarter. He gets the first. So Killens, who's not quite felt it here, and he goes to the bench a little dejected, showing a little body language. No good. Nine-point ball game. You a little surprised that the guards that we had talked about coming on into this one haven't been quite as big a factor, whether it's Deshaun Krim or Trey Killens?
See if they get a charge, and they are. But to answer your point, they're going to get a charge here on the Indians, going to turn over to the Comets. But to answer your question, I think, you know, I had not seen Mason a significant amount this year. I did get the chance to see them at Oak Hills. Oak Hills doesn't really have the guards, per se, that this Fairfield Indian bunch has. I think that they're in a disadvantage right now because Coney's a big guard that can go down to the paint, and then you match that up with a guy like Rodgers, and they don't really have a matchup for him. So they're having a tough time guarding inside the paint.
Long-range shot, Matthew Smith, no good. And Coney wants to run. Three for Woods. He can't get it to fall, and this place would have blown up had he put it in. Smith to the rack, has it rejected. Oh, that's a beauty for Amir Rodgers.
I think that they're going to say that it slipped out of his hand before Rodgers touched it. It's going to stay Indians basketball, which is a little bit of a break for the Indians. One thing I've noticed, though, here lately is Coach Weirich or someone at halftime has told their guys that they can get out and run. Whether they think they can get easy buckets on transition or not, or maybe Mason's just more concerned about getting rebounds on their end versus getting back, every single time the Indians catch a rebound, watch, they push tempo to see if they can get an easy basket.
Rodgers trying to set a screen, but the double on Coney, and it's taken away. Up front. And the layup is good. Two for Bryson King.
That's really been the offensive story for both of these teams this game, is what can they happen on the defensive end that will lead to a bucket on the offensive end.
37-30.
Good hands by Morton.
Krim saves it, and we have a timeout. Timeout charge to Fairfield with 2:21 left to play here in this third period. Along with Trace Fowler, I'm Geoff Kim. We want to remind you to stick around after the game, and it might literally be right after the game, for the box score. Reed, Sean, and Trace will catch you up on the scores around the area, highlights from tonight's games, the top five highlights of the last week, which is a new feature in this season, right?
Yeah.
And if you're lucky, Reed may approve of my top 10 picks going in this week. That's the box score, approximately 10:30 right here on Twitter. You know, and it's funny, Reed is producing us tonight. He gave me kind of a little side-eye look, kind of like, I don't know how to respond to that. So the beauty of being a bully on the pulpit right now on the mic.
Well, we shall see. Right now you're on the right side of history, per se, but I don't know if that's going to be the case towards the end of the year with your rankings, but hey, they're fun.
Well, they're meant to cause argument. And I think that's the one thing that we think about when we think about sports talk, right? Do you want everybody agreeing with each other, or do you want to have a little fist fight in the hallway?
Well,
I want the latter.
There's a
walk out of the timeout, it's a Krim travel.
That it was. Krim dragged his foot just a little too far there, and really another unforced turnover for this Indian bunch on the offensive end. We'll see if Mason can find their way. They obviously check Killens back into the game here. That's some instant offense, but they got to find a way to put the ball in the net from the outside, in my opinion. You know, this Mason team likes to shoot the three, and they're just not having their way on the inside.
Killens handles for Morton. They work it around. Pitcock gets a touch. Back to Killens, and now Morton again with under two to play here in this third. 37-30. we had 10 lead changes. I think officially the score, the official score had it at 8, but somewhere between 8 and 10 lead changes in the first half. We've not seen anything. It's been Fairfield in control in the second half. 3 on the way for Pitcock.
Yeah, that's what they need to do as the Comets, is stretch this defense, especially when you got guys out there like Rogers, who has to guard one of these guards. If you're going to have a disadvantage on the defensive end having to guard Rogers, you got to take advantage of it on the offensive end.
4-point contest. What was once a 10-point lead has dropped to 4. Krim has the ball. Checked by Morton. Makes his move as he switches hands, now skips it back outside. And they'll reset the offense with 1:13 to go.
A lot of standing around right now by the Indians and a lot of dribbling.
Coney, oh, nice curl into the lane for 2.
Well, that was bad offense, which led to a positive outcome. I don't think that's the type of offense that's going to have much success, but the Indians will take it here as they come down to the end of the third.
Max Johnson back outside. Killens, who really hasn't gotten started here in this game since the first quarter. And we've got some contact in the lane.
Beautiful job by Morton of hesitating there and bringing Rogers out. And I said it once, I'll say it again. That is the answer on the offensive end right now for the Comets. Get one of these guards, extend Rogers out, and perhaps get him in foul trouble. A little bit of a hesitation right there. You can see the pump fake. It brought Rogers off his feet. Rogers couldn't get out of the way in time to pick up the personal, and that's, you want to get him out of the game? Well, let him pick up a couple personals.
Right, and you know, right now the big man has 3. That's, they have 5 fouls on the board. Well, no, they do give them 3. And now it is 5 team fouls on the home team Fairfield. Just 2 team fouls here in the second half for the Comets. Killens will handle against Woods. Morton outside the arc on the right. Driving in on Bronston. Nice feed inside for 2. Bryson King.
Yeah, good job by Morton of looking up and seeing King on the inside. And King doing a good job of spacing out some area right there in the middle of the paint for an easy lay-in.
King has 8 off the bench. 39-35. 15 seconds to go here in this third period. Coney handling, looking for a screen, now penetrates, taking it, lost the ball, got it back, and he stepped out of bounds, and he didn't have control as he went out anyways. So 6.2 seconds left to go, and Mason could play for a final shot here in this third period.
Yeah, they got Coney for a double dribble. I'll have to look back at that here.
Johnson up the sideline. 3-2, and he airmails this one, and that's how this third period ends. Well, we got some excitement here in the back half of the third period, and it's a 4-point contest, 39-35. This is the Greater Miami Conference on Chatterbox Live. Eight more minutes left to go here in our feature match in the GMC. Along with Trace Fowler, I'm Geoff Kim. Thanks for joining us here on Chatterbox Live. We've been entertained here in this one. Up to 10 lead changes here in this one. It's been Fairfield since the start of this third period. Into the fourth we go. Killens top of the key. Pitcock feeds inside. Pitcock for 3. He knocks it down, and he makes it a 1-point contest.
Pitcock really has been their spark on the offensive end so far in the second half. A couple outside trays to get them right back into it.
He's got 9 in the book off the bench. Firm has it. Check by Morton. He thought about step back 3, and now they'll play it back. Murphy, we haven't seen in a while. He drains the 15-footer.
And we were in a perfect spot to see the angle on that. It almost looked like he shot it over the glass. They're going to count that. Wow.
So Killens gets 2 more, and he'll go to the line.
You can see the replay here. Or there was going to be a replay. We'll stick around here for Killen's free throw.
And he completes the old-fashioned 3-point play. We are tied, 41 apiece. Third tie of the ball game. Well, remember that you've been on a run of final shots in the last
seconds. Don't jinx us now.
Rogers into the paint. Murphy, wraparound pass. Draws the double team and now kicks it out. 3 on the way, knock it down, and that's a lead for Fairfield. Woods with three more.
Good set here for Mason. Nice patience. And I'll tell you, I'd try to see if I can't get the ball right back into Pitcock's hands.
Drive, Killens to the rack.
Not if it's that easy for Killens. A good job of recognizing he had a mismatch. Killens, Krim, Coney, Woods, Murphy, Pitcock.
Oh,
amazing guards here tonight.
Yes, there are. So some contact there. It's Pitcock reaching in on Murphy. That's just the third team foul for Mason here in this quarter, or in this half. By the way, the fouls are at six for Fairfield, so the next one will be one on the bonus for Mason. 1 point lead. Woods has it, center jump circle, plays out. Here's Krim for three, he knocks it down! His first points of the night!
With a quick turnover, here comes Williams.
A three on two. Coney drops it off. Woods no good, the missed the bunny. Murphy saves it. Coney stuck at the elbow on the double team and they'll reset the offense with 5:35 to go. A 4 point lead once again for Fairfield. Krim fakes the pass, he goes up, he lost the handle, and it'll stay up front with 5:27 to play.
That it was, and we got a replay here. You can see, I believe it's gonna be Krim on the open three. You said it was his first points of the night. Let's rip from the outside, and it's gone back and forth, back and forth. My goodness, I know there's been a multiple lead changes, but more importantly, it's been momentum swings. Makes you miss the crowd a bit, doesn't it?
I mean,
one of those things where I'm glad we're playing, but boy, oh boy, do you miss the crowd.
Well, we are glad to have the friends and family here in attendance, but it is, as you say, right? A moment like what we just saw with the Krim 3 would have blown up this arena. Here's Warden up high on the left. Nice feed inside for Killens. He gets the bunny.
Wow. I mean, we're just incredibly offensive-minded players out here right now that are just finishing.
47-45. Well, you remember the game that we had a week ago over at Lakota East where the bucket to our left side was the one with the easy rim. Here's a three again for Krim. This time he can't get it to fall. Killens wants to run. He's got a two on one. He drops it off for Morton to the rack. He drew the foul.
Really a good foul by Logan Murphy, realizing that, you know, he was beat, and he made it a good job of realizing that if he was going to foul, he was not going to give up the basket.
Murphy picks up number four. So he's going to have to sit as Jalen Berlew will take his place in the Fairfield lineup. But he did get his money's worth on the foul. I mean, he prevented the and one.
Prevented the and one and prevented the easy lay-in. All for naught, though, as Morton knocks them both down.
And we are tied again. This is our fourth tie of the night, knotted up at 47. You know, it's funny, Trace. I know that I had lobbied coming on in to do East versus West. And let it be said that the wisdom of my partner has prevailed tonight. We've got a good one. And not that that wasn't a good one. That one did come down to the final 30 seconds or so in that game.
That it is. They're going to get Eli Jordan here on hand checking outside. And they're starting to change the way they're officiating this basketball game. At the very beginning of this, they were allowing hand checking to go on proverbially in any situation, whether it be an arm bar, whether it be a hip check. Did not matter. They were not calling it. And now they're starting to kind of, I guess you'd say, call the hand checks.
Berlew gets a touch. Gets it up to Krim. Deshaun.
Good pass.
Oh, high low for Woods. He gets the bucket. On the assist by Krim.
This is a situation where if you're Mason, be patient.
Oh, Johnson all by himself.
Very good job of Johnson, and really a bad defensive effort from Krim getting out of position, and that's going to be a block. No, they are going to call an offensive.
Charge. By the way, this is our fifth tie of the ball game as we come up on the halfway point of this fourth quarter. Good one to be sure tonight.
Tell you what, that offensive foul slash block is just, it's so difficult to really get a grasp on what's what. I do think he was in a good guarding position. I don't really have too much of a beef with that one. It just seems like I get him more wrong than right.
Johnson, who scored the last bucket, puts it on the floor. Smith now has it with a left-hand dribble. Outside, King for three off the wing. He can't get it to fall. Krim the rebound for Fairfield. A bucket will give him the lead. He penetrates. Oh, the nice scoop. He can't get it to fall, and it will go the other way. Last touch by the shooter.
Yeah, and Krim's so crafty inside there. You got to live with that sometimes. You know, you got to understand that sometimes he's going to make those and everybody's going to ooh and aah, but there's going to be moments where it just doesn't go down. That's one of those moments.
Here's a straight-on three for Killens. He can't get it to fall. Out of bounds. It's a turnover on possession back to Fairfield.
Yeah, when we have 3 minutes and 21 seconds left to play, we're only talking three or four possessions here, Geoff. These are the winning plays. This is the winning time. You want to talk about a headlines play of the night? It's getting ready to come in the next 3 minutes.
Krim has it up high on the right. Pitcock has the assignment. Amir Rogers returns it to Krim.
Coney wants the basketball inside right now. He's got Killens on him. We'll see if they can find a way to get it to him.
Straight up man defense here for the Comets. And now Rogers tried to set the screen. He gets the ball. He lost the handle. It's taken away. And we've got a foul on the reach in. Stealing it there was Matthew Smith. And he was going to go to the basket unabated.
Yeah, it wasn't a bad foul by Rogers, but another foul nonetheless on him, and every single time you pick up one, that's going to be his fourth personal, so something to keep an eye on here late in the game. But another situation where they're bringing out a ball screen on Krim, who I think can get to the rim on anybody, quite frankly, and you kind of start muddying the situation up when you bring it out, and they doubled Krim. Krim kind of made a pass that Rogers couldn't handle, and it led to a turnover.
First one is good. Well, I think I understand the point on that, Trace. It's like the screen that Rogers tried to set was well-meaning, but it was unnecessary at that part of the court. Mason has retaken the lead on the Smith free throw, and they go up by two.
It's like Coach Richards is going to take a timeout here and probably imploring his guys to understand they're going to have to play team defense. They're going to ultimately, in my guess, throw the ball down inside to one of the either. Like, I know Rogers is the premier guy that you'd want to throw the ball down into, but quite frankly, so far tonight, I trust the sophomore. I think Coney, if he's matched up on Killens, take nothing away from Killens, but it's just a different physical matchup, and I think it's in the Indians' favor.
2-point lead for Mason. And we got a good one here. And also, while you were talking, I got a text from Nathaniel Hipsley, and just wanted to say that he had a good one out there over at East, over at the Hawk's Nest. West, by the way, broke a 5-year drought in winning that crosstown shootout, winning by 54-50 tonight.
Yeah, good for Coach Leon and those kids. And they got a young nucleus, if you will, of players in Dukovic and Turner, and led by a little bit of leadership from Weber. And like I said, this league is tough to figure out, man. This game, quite frankly, the Indians have kind of taken control of the majority of the game, but here come the Comets. They always find ways to seem to win in these types of situations. We'll see if they can do it again.
By the way, real quickly, kudos to Fairfield's athletic trainer, Diana Vukovic. I'm being recognized as the recipient of the Bill Walker Memorial Award for Athletic Training Excellence. Her leadership within the GMC has made her school and, of course, the conference proud. Three on the way for Woods. He knocks it down.
That
and Fairfield
is
has regained the lead.
Big time play, Geoff. That ball doesn't go down. You risk going down two possessions with under 2 minutes, and you get in a situation where you might have to foul. Instead, you're up by one.
52-51 on a big three by Logan Woods. Johnson stuck outside the lane. Killen's thinking about three now, penetrates. He lost the handle. Murphy reached in and got away. It's saved by Mason. Johnson will handle, and we have another timeout. This time charged to Mason.
Looks like we're going to have another replay here. Three-pointer in the corner from Woods. And like I said, if he misses that shot, Mason pulls down the rebound. You have a chance to go down by two possessions. Instead, you're up by one. You had mentioned the athletic trainer there, Ivkovic, by the way. And the only reason I know that, to be fair, is a small world. Is my wife works at Mercy Fairfield with her daughter-in-law.
Oh, great.
And I know her very well, and she's very well-meaning. Been in this district. One of the very few athletic trainers left that's actually, I guess, to be employed by the actual district. Right? She is an employee of Fairfield City Schools. And most of the athletic trainers anymore, they come from the, you know, the various hospitals, if you will. And she's been here for, you know, a long time, if you will. So
well, that
congratulations
honors,
to her.
That honor is well-deserved. I appreciate the correction on the pronunciation. And I guess I got to tell you, that reminds me of a little story, right? You know, with names from an Eastern Bloc or a Polish descent, right? I remember back when I was in my Wright State days in broadcasting, a baseball game, in fact, for them. And it was a Wright State game against Cleveland State. And everybody in Cleveland apparently had a V-I-C-H ending to their name. It was just ridiculous. There were literally four players on that nine-man roster that day that had V-I-C-H as a suffix to their name, to their surname. 2 minutes to play out of the timeout. Smith keeping it on the deck, a double screen set for him on top, and we got a hold.
That we do, and they're in the bonus, and that's going to put him in the double bonus, which will give him two free throws at the line. A guy that's had a good night so far in Pidcock. We'll see if he can answer here for the Comets.
That's number two on Ray Coney. As you mentioned, the double bonus. Pidcock off the bench. Three trays. And, I mean, he has been a sharpshooter from outside, but he can't get the free throw to fall. You know, and I feel like that's the long ball shooter's curse sometimes.
I've lived it. It's tough.
He's got 10 in the book. And we have our sixth tie of the night. And by the way, Trace, you know how I keep runs and scores on this. My run sheet is starting to run out. So we need this to finish in regulation, by the way. Otherwise, I'm going to have some problems.
Oh, come on.
Little ticky-tack foul here on this near end in front of us.
Yeah, thankfully they're not in the bonus. But it's, like I said before, the way they were calling this game all game long perhaps is just very physical. Nothing wrong with keeping it that way.
That's number two on Killen. It's just five team fouls in the second half for Mason. Coney works in on Killens. That's a good matchup tonight. They switch, and now he draws the double. He steps through, lost the handle. It's loose on the floor, and Mason comes away with it. And they can take a lead with a bucket here with a minute and a half to go.
Mason on the last possession was trying to get the ball inside to Morton. Let's see if they do something like that here.
King has it, sets it up. Johnson to the rack, has a shot rejected. He was out of control, but it'll stay up front as it was rejected out of bounds by the big man.
Yeah, at this point, I think Murphy's out there with four, along with Rogers. Got to play smart, but obviously you can't give up a bucket in this situation. You got to go all out. If it means fouling out, then I guess that's what it means at this point in the game.
Tied at 52. Bryson King gets it off the entry, gives it up to the Pepper Pot guard. He lost the handle, and unfortunately got tripped up incidentally, but that's a foul.
Oh, that can't be on Logan Murphy. That's got to be on Logan Woods.
Yeah, Murphy is saying, who, me?
Yeah, that can't be on Logan Murphy.
And now we'll have a confab.
If you're Logan Woods right now, you got to come over and beg it. Hey, that was on me. That was on me. Try to keep your guy in the game.
DJ Weirich out there pleading his case. And this is a potential tide turner here in this game with 1:05 to go.
Yeah, Coach Weirich is vividly upset. And I don't blame him, quite frankly, because the foul was on Logan Woods. That fouls out a guy like Logan Murphy, who's had a hell of a night so far tonight. And it's a mistake, quite frankly. I mean,
it's a human game, unfortunately, and sometimes. And when it comes to this, the situations are critical. As Coney will come on in, and Murphy will exit the game. And he had a fine night, like you said, 13 points in the book.
He did, and I feel sorry for him because he's out there holding his hands up like, that wasn't on me. He got the wrong number.
Mason has retaken the lead on the Killens free throw. Got them both. And by the way, I was just informed by Nathaniel Hipsley that Moeller has lost tonight to a team in Southwest Ohio. So I'm expecting a full amount of snow to come down because hell may have frozen over. Dribbling for Coney. And this one, a whistle stopping it with 47.2 to play.
Fortunately for the Comets, as I mentioned, it's only their sixth team foul, so it won't send Coney to the line. But you got to guard the three right now if you're the Comets. You do not want to get beat by a Logan Woods three. I look around out there. Perhaps Logan Woods is the biggest threat. Obviously, Deshaun Krim's capable. But you do not want to get beat by Logan Woods in the three-pointer.
Bronson has it, plays Krim. He draws the double immediately and a hold on Mason.
Yeah, and I think the Indians might have gotten a little bit of a break because Krim might have shuffled his feet there as he caught the ball. Krim had the opportunity to beat it if he had made an instant decision to dribble through there, but he might have gotten bailed out perhaps. Hey, you said it's a human game.
Yes.
And sometimes it evens out.
So Morton picks up his third. And two very big free throw opportunities right here. Krim makes the first. Now, if he does make this one right now, do you foul if you're Fairfield at any point?
I think you're going to get a timeout by Coach Weirich, if I had to guess. And I think that you're going to not foul because you're tied. You're saying if he misses?
Yes.
Well, we don't have to worry about that now. But I don't think you foul until there's 20 seconds left or less if you're only down by one.
Seventh tie of the ball game, knotted up at 54. And here we go.
If you're Fairfield, see if you can't double one of these guys and get the ball out of their hand and do not let them take the last shot.
Smith plays to Morton, and we got a timeout charge to Mason. They want to talk it over. Greg Richards on the bench wants to set up a play with 24.7 to go.
Yeah, I think that at this point Mason's indication is clear. They want to take the last shot, as they should. But if you're Coach Weirich, I think you try to tell your guys, hey, do you remember what happened to us just a few nights ago? That can happen to them now.
Yes.
Can we find a way to force the issue? Do not allow them to just dribble it out and then take it down to 10 seconds and take the shot. It might lead to a lay-in, but they got to break it. They got to make it. And if it does lead to a lay-in within 10 seconds, I'll be frank, you got a chance to answer on the opposite end. I've just never been a proponent of just allowing the team to just take the last shot without forcing it. Will they take the last shot? Possibly. But if I had my choice, I'm going to double somebody and try to make them a little uncomfortable.
So out of the timeout, the ball will be entered in by Matthew Smith, slide out of bounds right out of in front of his bench. Is Killen's your first opportunity here?
I actually like Morton because he's matched up on Rogers, and Morton can extend Rogers out.
And Rogers is in foul trouble as well. Killens has it with 20 to go. He works in and a little reach in. I mean, we're talking such a tiny one for Logan Woods, who picks up his second. Wow. With 18.3 to go. Did you see a real block on that one, by the way? I think your science is telling me something.
I have no, I mean, there's 18 seconds left in the game, Geoff. You can go back through and watch this game. That was not called a block, and now they're taking the ball away from him when he's at the line. At some point, we need to figure it out in the stripes, quite frankly.
No good. A brick off the back end.
And it's not even that, you know, there's a rooting interest here. I just want to see this end the way that it should. And I don't think it should end at the line the way that this game's been called all night long.
Killens, he makes one of two.
Now if you're Fairfield, take the first good shot. First available good shot. It might be the last second. It might be in the next 5 seconds. Looks like we're going to time out here by coach.
And we do. Coney has the ball with 13.8 to go, 55-54. Now, I know that we had differed on exchanges of lead here in this ballgame with the official score, but I still have it down for 14 lead changes tonight.
Yeah.
An impressive ballgame.
Absolutely. I think that both of these teams have shown why they're at the top of the league and why they'll probably be a force to be reckoned with towards the end of this year. Fairfield 5-1 in the league, Mason 4-2, but as you mentioned, Mason's only had losses to East twice, and East, a team that you traditionally see at the top of this league, and they win games, but they're starting to kind of fall down here, and we'll see if they've had kind of, I don't want to say they're in trouble in regards to losing the league title yet, but they're certainly nearing that. But if everyone keeps beating up on each other, then who knows what happens at the end of this. And I know what Reed Mouse would tell us, and he's saying, hey, there's a team that's 4-2 in the Hamilton Big Blue. And I say, hey, there's a team at 5-2, and their name Lakota West. At this point, we might want to start considering the Firebirds a threat here at the top of this
league. By the way, with that Lakota West win over Lakota East, East falls to 4-2 in conference. Right now, the only one-loss team in conference is Fairfield, pending the outcome of this one. Right. So if they end up losing in the conclusion of this one with 13.8 to go, you have a lot of two-loss teams up top in the GMC.
Five to be exact, so half the league has got a two-loss team. So we will see. It'll make fun. It'll make for fun, but I'm sure these Indians would like to stay right there at the top with that one loss. And here we go.
Logan Woods will enter in from in front of his own bench. Coney has it with 10 seconds to play. Off the high screen. He rolls to the bucket. He goes to the rec. Blocking call! It's on Mason!
And that's the right call, quite frankly. He shuffled his feet just a little bit, wasn't in position, and Coney's going to go to the line for two.
Bryson King picks up his second, and two big free throw opportunities here with 5.3 to go here for Ray Coney.
These are big time free throws for just a sophomore.
He ties it up.
Now, if you're Coach Richards, do you call a timeout to try to ice him and set up your offense for a rebound? Looks like they are not.
He's got arms akimbo, waiting to see the outcome of this. Coney with a very big free throw here. The right-hander eyes it and puts it through for the lead.
Got to stop the ball if you're the Indians. Can Killens get
Killens
to the lane?
Dumps it down low. The wraparound for Martin with 0.2 seconds left to go. Out of bounds. It belongs to Fairfield, and they'll hold on. Wow.
You can see right here Killens a little out of control, but makes a good pass, and it just barely trickles off of Morton's hand. Morton was in position to lay it in, just couldn't quite handle the pass, and it was a tough pass nonetheless. But you had mentioned, you can see our scoreboard says 0-0, but it is 0-0.2. Essentially, it's over. Fire one at the end of the court, touch it, and that will do it. They're going to change it to 8/10 of a second. So that changes things slightly.
Yep, and now you have an opportunity to set up for a potential shot somewhere or defend it and tip it back in. 56-55. Well, you know what? This is the third game in a row that you've seen, well, at least come down to the final, let's call it the last 5 seconds.
Certainly, yeah, one possession games. And I would say if you're the Indians right now, the only thing that can't happen is you can't throw the ball out of bounds without it being touched. Right, I would argue you could just throw this thing towards midcourt and Mason would be able to catch it and they wouldn't be able to get a shot off in time, quite frankly. But I don't know if you'd like to do that, because do you really trust the clock operator to start it in time? I don't know. I will say this: these are the pressure moments to being a clock operator, because traditionally one side's going to complain whether it started too early or didn't start quick enough.
Fantastic finish here in this one tonight. Unofficially 15 lead changes in this one and 7 ties.
Are you allowed to give a headlines play of the game to not a very sexy thing?
I think so.
And I tell you what, for being a sophomore, for knowing the situation, it's not like he went to the line. I'm talking about Ray Coney, obviously. It's not like he went to the line tied and you can't lose it. He went to the line down by one.
Right.
Knocked in the first and knocked in the second. I don't know if he hit the rim, quite frankly. We'll see what they do here.
Here's the entry in from Krim. Up front, and Fairfield's all alone in the GMC. 56-55, the winner tonight for Fairfield, as they rebound from a heartbreak in Middletown on Tuesday to claim a heartwarming win tonight here on this beautiful Friday night in Fairfield. Mercy.
You can see Coney getting ambushed, if you will. His teammates are proud of him, and he should be proud of himself and the rest of this gang of this Indian bunch. But take nothing away from Mason. Second time I've been able to see them this year. They're not going to go away. This is a fun league. You know, I think that it's a surprise. There's been teams that you thought were going to be at the top. Not quite so. And you get teams like this Indian bunch who's starting to make a name for themselves.
A fantastic night for the Indians as they improve to 7-4. They're all alone at the top of the GMC at 6-1. The Mason Comets dropped their second straight. 8-3 is their record. 4-3 in conference. Just a fantastic finish tonight here for Fairfield. Coming back and winning on free throws. And as we are one to say, free throws don't win every game.
They just win them. They just win the ones that are close. What you tell me, I might have butchered it just a bit.
You got it. You got a partner.
But they win the ones that matter, I can tell you that.
Well, they certainly do. And again, Ray Coney might be the hero of the game, but tonight, you know, you have to look at Logan Woods, who had 4 big threes. And I know Logan Murphy on the other side, especially in the first half, had 3 big threes, really, to kind of punctuate the long ball tonight. And, you know, it's funny. We mentioned this here in the last 3 games. You win by the long ball, you die by the long ball. They've died by it on Tuesday, but they've won the bookend games.
Yeah, I think that what's weird about the whole situation with Fairfield is if you made them pick which way you'd – if you told them you have to lose either Mason or Middletown, the wise one would say, hey, let's lose against Middletown because Mason might be fending for the league championship at the end of the year. If we can beat them, that gives them one more loss. I would venture to say that Coach Weirich would say, hey, we'd like to win them both.
Yes.
But hey, that's what's crazy about this league. You got a team like Middletown who struggled a little bit. They beat the top dog, and then the top dog in Fairfield proves tonight, yeah, they can handle the pressure.
Got to put you on the spot. Your headlines play of the game is the unsexy free throws or something else?
I do think it's the unsexy free throws, but I will also say that 3 in the corner by Logan Woods was enormous, and it shouldn't go unnoticed, and it shouldn't go unmentioned.
And maybe that might be our play of the game. And it's brought to you no matter what by Headlines Apparel. And you'll see it tonight on the box score. Be sure to stick around shortly for the box score. Reed, Sean, and Trace will catch you up on all the scores around the area. Highlights from this amazing game and all the other ones. And the top 5 highlights of the last week. And that's right on here on the box score at 10:30. Right here on Chatterbox Live and on Twitter. Final thoughts?
No, I think that box score is calling my name. I'm going to have to get back there, considering we're gotten a late one.
Let's call it a night. Thank you, partner. We'll see you next week. Again, the final 56-55. Fairfield survives a gut-wrenching win tonight. Thanks go out to our entire Chatterbox Live crew. For Trace Fowler, I'm Geoff Kim. Good night from Fairfield Arena.